Welcome to Reliance Capital Q1 FY19 Earnings Conference Call. Today we have with us Mr. Anmol Ambani, ED Reliance Capital, along with other senior team members to discuss earnings and key business strategies going forward. So over to you, Anmol.
Good morning to all of you and welcome to our Q1 FY19 Earnings Conference Call. We have the CEOs from our businesses with us, Devang Modi from Reliance Commercial Finance, Ravindra Sudhalkar from Home Finance, Rakesh Jain from Reliance General Insurance, Ashish Vora from Reliance Nippon Life Insurance, and Gop Kumar from the Broking and Distribution segment, as well as Reliance Capital CFO Amit Bhavna. Also, we have Pratik Jain, CFO, Reliance Nippon Life Asset Management with us. We have made a transition to Ind AS with effect from April 1st, 2018. Hence, the consolidated results conform to the revised standards. However, since Ind AS is not applicable to insurance companies, the standalone results of Reliance General Insurance and Reliance Nippon Life Insurance are based on IRDAI reporting. I'm very happy to state that the total income for the quarter increased by 4% to 46.4 billion and profit rose to 2.7 billion. In terms of operating performance, the core businesses have achieved significant improvement in profitability. Now we will present a brief update on our core businesses' performance, beginning with Pratik Jain from Reliance Nippon Life Asset Management.
I am very happy to state that Reliance Nippon Life Asset Management is one of the India's largest asset managers with rupees 4.1 trillion of assets under management, an increase of 12% over the previous corresponding quarter. Reliance Mutual Fund is one of the largest players in the mutual fund space with a focus on high-yielding assets. As a result, share of equity assets rose from 29% to 37% for the quarter ended June 30, 2018. The number of systematic investment plans, SIPs, folios rose from 2.8 million, resulting in annualized book of approximately rupees 100 billion. We continue to be among the leaders in beyond top 30 city segments. This segment contributes AUM of more than 390 billion. Over 16% of the total assets were sourced from this segment, as against an industry average of 14%. Reliance Mutual Fund has added the highest retail assets of rupees 196 billion. Currently, it manages overall retail assets of rupees 780 billion, among the highest in the industry. Digital purchases rose by 26% to 146,000 for the quarter ended June 30, 2018. RLM is one of the largest players in the ETF space with a 15.4% market share and average asset under management of rupees 129 billion for the quarter ended June 30, 2018. RM is the only AMC to have 16 years of track record in managing ETFs. On our international businesses, we closely work with Nippon Life Insurance. As of June 2018, RM manages and advises an assets worth approximately rupees 83 billion from offshore regions. Reliance AF has a commitment of rupees 22 billion across various AF schemes as on June 2018. For the quarter ended June 2018, RM's total income increased to rupees 4.2 billion, while profit before tax rose to 6% to rupees 1.6 billion. I would now invite Mr. Devang Modi from Reliance Commercial Finance for his comments.
Thanks. We have rebranded Reliance Commercial Finance as Reliance Money as the consumer-facing brand, focusing on our current strengths as well as transforming our company into diversified new-age financial service provider, both in commercial as well as retail space. The AUM increased 6% in the quarter gone by to 188 billion, while the outstanding loan book rose 16% to 165 billion. Total income for quarter increased marginally to 5.2 billion. Profit before tax rose by 47% to 723 million rupees. Net interest margin was steady at 5.8% versus 6.1% in corresponding quarter last year. Cost-to-income ratio remains stable at 32% for this quarter. As on June 18, the gross NPA improved significantly to 2.9% versus 4.1% in corresponding quarter last year on a 90-day basis. Also, our net NPA ratio is at 1.1% as on first quarter FY19. Our provisioning coverage ratio now improved to 63% for end of this quarter. The business caters to over 75,000 customers in 150 cities in India. We continue to rebalance our portfolio and improve asset quality. We also entered retail finance space in FY18 and have initiated lending in two-wheeler and personal loan segment. In retail segment, our strong growth is backed by state-of-the-art operations platform, which we have created over a period of last two quarters. Our lending platform is built on Salesforce.com workflow. All retail loans are disbursed using FICO decision engine. This creates very agile risk management capability for our future growth. For the quarter ended June 30th, 2018, we have disbursed over 27,000 retail loans leveraging this digital lending platform from over 1,000 distribution points. We continue to expand in retail segment and we create significant presence in this space in coming quarters. I would now invite Ravindra Sudhakar from Reliance Home Finance for his comments.
Thanks, Devang. Reliance Home Finance Limited is in the business of home loans, including the affordable segment, loan against property, and construction funding. In Q1 of FY19, the assets under management grew by 21% to Rs. 156 billion. The total income for the quarter increased by 5% to Rs. 4.1 billion. It should be noted that the interest income was up by 20%. However, adjusting it against the Ind AS impact on investment and securitization, the net impact is 5%. The profit before tax rose by 56% to Rs. 724 million. The net interest margin for the quarter after adjusting for NPA reversals was at 3.2%. Our guidance continues to remain in the range of 3.3 to 3.5% as we grow our portfolio in the affordable home loan segment. As on June 2018, the gross NPAs remain stable at 0.8% of the assets under management. This is the sixth consecutive quarter that this number is at 0.8%. The company had a capital adequacy ratio of 21% as on June 2018 with a Tier 1 ratio of 14%. Reliance Home Finance continues to enjoy highest rating of A1 plus for its short-term borrowing program and AA plus for its long-term borrowing program. We are operational in approximately 140 locations in the country through the hub-and-spoke model and would continue to expand this footprint. I would now invite Rakesh Jain from Reliance General Insurance for his comments.
Thanks, Ravi. The general insurance industry witnessed strong growth of 12% in quarter 1 FY19, growing across multiple segments, primarily health and motor. Reliance General Insurance is amongst the top private sector general insurance companies in India in terms of gross premium, with a market share of about 8.8%. The gross written premium rose better than the industry to Rs. 16 billion, an increase of 23%. Also, premium from preferred segments such as private cars, health and travel, as well as commercial lines continue to grow in line or better than the industry. For the quarter ended June 30, 2018, profits rose by 30% to Rs. 574 million. The combined ratio for the quarter remained stable at 104%. For the quarter ended June 30, 2018, the combined ratio for short tail business continued to be below 95. The investment book increased by 20% to Rs. 83 billion as on June 2018. For the quarter ended June 2018, the return on equity rose from 14% to 16%. The solvency ratio is maintained at 161% as against a regulatory minimum of 150%. The company has registered a sharp increase in online channel with 32% growth in premium collected and 24% growth in number of policies sold in the quarter. Our focus has been to improve profitability as well as our market share. The company continued to diversify its distribution network with a strong lineup of bank assurance partnership with major banks. As on June 2018, we have the largest agency force in the private sector with over 28,000 retail agents and 129 branches across the country. Reliance General Insurance has concluded distribution tie-up with over 35 financial institutions, and also the company has aligned itself with several strong automotive manufacturers. I would now invite Ashish Vora from Reliance Nippon Life Insurance for his comments.
Thanks, Rakesh. I am very happy to state that our journey of quality and profitability continues in a steady manner, in a manner in which we had predicted earlier, and the progress across key metrics has been on predicted lines. The total premium in this quarter increased by 8% to rupees 7.5 billion, while renewal premium increased by 6% to rupees 5.5 billion. Individual WRP rose by 23% to rupees 1.7 billion in Q1 FY19. This growth rate is more than the industry growth rate for the quarter. As a conscious business strategy, we continue to stay focused on the traditional product segment, which formed 69% of the individual new business premium in QYFY18, therefore supporting profitability. Overall persistency rose sharply from 66% to 71% as of June 2018. The business continues to focus on agency and proprietary channels, which have a persistency of over 70%. Continued growth in renewal premium along with higher persistency demonstrates our emphasis on improving the quality of business even further. In Q1 FY19, the business made a marginal profit of rupees 3 million as compared to a loss of rupees 138 million in Q1 FY18. Sum assured of policies in force rose to rupees 965 billion. There are approximately 3 million policies in force. We operate the company through a network of 750 offices and 52,000 active advisors across India. With support from better agency productivity, higher persistency and improved margins, we expect to improve profitability and continue to grow in market share. Total funds under management grew by 11% in this quarter to rupees 193 billion as of June 2018. The business employs the traditional method of calculating embedded value as of March 2018, the embedded value was rupees 32.2 billion. I now invite Gop Kumar from the broking and distribution segment for his comments.
Thank you, Ashish. Reliance Securities is among the leading equity broker and distributor of financial products and services in India. The number of equity broking accounts increased by 5% across to 8,60,000 clients. Average daily turnover from the equity segment rose by 29% to rupees 51 billion. The average daily turnover in cash segment was at 3 billion in the quarter ended 31st June 2019. 97% of new broking accounts are digitally opened and clients are able to trade on the same day. The number of commodity broking accounts rose by 21%. Average commodity turnover rose by 26% to rupees 3 billion. In wealth management business, our assets management stood at 51 billion, an increase of 29%. For the quarter, the total income increased by 10% at rupees 821 million. The business had a profit of 77 million in quarter 1, FY18, an increase of 316%. Now I would like to invite Anmol to do his closing remarks.
Thanks, Gop. We continue to be solely focused on the financial services sector. We aim to achieve a leadership position in core businesses. We expect to improve our market ranking across businesses over the next few quarters, as well as achieve a return on equity in the range of 15 to 18% in each of them. Also, the independent listing of Reliance General Insurance is expected to create further value for our shareholders. With these comments, we would now like to take your questions. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Ladies and gentlemen, we will now begin the question and answer session. Anyone who wishes to ask a question may press star and one on their touchtone telephone. If you wish to remove yourself from the question queue, you may press star and two. Participants are requested to use handset while asking a question. Ladies and gentlemen, we will wait for a moment while the question queue assembles. We will take the first question from the line of Kajal Gandhi from ICICI Direct. Please go ahead.
Hello. Good morning, sir. So, firstly, I would like to know about the adjustments that have happened. So, where are these MTM and ECL provisions coming from? Which assets and the opening net worth that and at net worth as on today?
So we have, there's some ECL provisions we've done across all the exposures we had. So we've been conservative and hence you've seen that impact in Q1 of the previous financial year. Net worth remains similar to where we were in the past.
So we can quantify the number. So first thing, on this 400 crore, so is it relating to the group exposure that we were having on the ICDs and which are there under stress? So is it related to that, and how much overall we need to provide on these assets?
No, so whatever we needed to, we've already done, and you can see that in the Q1 results of the previous financial year. That's why that number is negative as of now. And that's about it, yeah.
Sir, MTM has been created on which investments?
So these are ECL provision on loan exposures. And that's why that's what's reflecting there.
So ECL is there around 400. So there's a MTM on investments also around 200 crore. So is that also loan or... is it some investments that...
No, so there would be some investments in group companies where there would be a fair valuation downwards as well. So we have CCDs exposure, so some part is in ECL format in loans and some part is fair valuation of those CCDs.
Sir, in terms of net worth, if you look at your opening net worth as on also closing net worth on 2017... and your stated assets, segment assets minus liabilities, that difference looks to be slightly larger. So is that the adjustment which is there? Because that number looks quite large.
Yeah. Yeah, I'll take you in detail on that bit. Yeah.
Okay, sir. And second thing on your... CF business also, are the provisions rising there, and home finance, the growth is coming down?
Yeah, on the CF business, that's the construction funding business you are referring to?
No, the commercial finance, sorry.
Oh, sorry.
So, commercial finance, actually, if you see on year-on-year basis, as we have actually reduced GNPA, yeah, and we have accelerated provisioning as well as through recovery, our net NPA is down to 1.1%. So incremental assets are significantly lower provisioning. Some of the traditional power exposures which we had from last 3 years, which was part of GNPA since last 18 months, some of them we have recovered, and some of them we have provided fully. That is what is leading to reduction in net NPA as well as increasing provisioning coverage ratio.
So as Ind AS has already come in the financing business, so is it that all the past problems that were there in the CF book are now taken care of?
I think I wouldn't call that there were past problems in commercial finance book. Yes, GNPA and net NPA was at elevated level. Some of it is passed through P&L and some of it is recovered. So, yes, we are at 1.1% net NPA, which would be benchmark or amongst the best among asset finance companies.
Okay, sir. So, and on the home finance, about the growth?
Yeah, so on the home finance front, if you look at it compared to the last June, there was a growth in the AUM. However, if you look at sequentially, there will be a slight degrowth. As I've mentioned earlier, we have an early warning signal mechanism at Reliance Home Finance. Although this is not mandated by the National Housing Bank, but we do it on a regular basis, and we take a stock of accounts which we need to attract early, and there were certain accounts which we have attracted early, wherein we could see stress coming in the years to come. And which is why, on a sequential quarters, there is slight correction on the AUM. However, year on year, there's a growth in the AUM.
So, were these from the LAB book or?
No. So, this was from the CF book, wherein there were certain projects wherein we could see that the sales were not happening, wherein we had asked the builders to come and pay us back the loan amount. There was even one LAP case. But as you are aware, on the LAP front, our ticket size is fairly lower than the market.
And most of the exposures by which we have reduced in quarter one were CF exposures.
So are we back? Will we be back on track on your 30-40% growth in the coming quarters?
Yes, we will be back on track.
Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you. We take the next question from the line of Sarvesh Gupta from Maximal Capital. Please go ahead.
Hello. Thank you, sir, for taking my question. I had few questions on the annual report which was published for FY18. So, sir, if I look at your standalone balance sheet, our stated objective has been that we will reduce the debt levels on the standalone balance sheet and we will also monetize the investment. Now, when I see the FY18 balance sheet, it looks like our net debt has...
This is the operator. I'm sorry to interrupt. Well, requesting you to please speak a bit louder as your audio is not very audible.
Yeah. Is it better now?
Yes, sir. You may please proceed. Thank you.
Yeah. So my question is that if I see the FY18 balance sheet, our net debt has approximately increased rather than decreased as per our stated objective by around 2,000 odd crores. And our investments in land have increased by around 1,200 crores.
Excuse me, Mr. Gupta, I'm sorry to interrupt again, but your audio is breaking up.
Is it better now?
So now it is better.
Yeah, so my question was that our net debt has actually increased rather than going down in our standalone balance sheet. And also our growth increases are tied for FY18 at around 1,650 crores versus just 120 crores in FY17. So how are we looking at things shaping up here in terms of net debt as well as the investments in non-subsidiary companies?
So in the standalone, we have seen a marginal increase in the net debt, but this year you should see a significant reduction in net debt. We have started monetizing a couple of our investments, including we monetized a gaming business of ours. We got in roughly 1,500 crores from there. We've exited Yatra. We are in the process of exiting a couple of our other private equity investments. So you should see a decline going forward in this space.
Okay. Okay, sir. But our major block is this long-term loans and advances, which are almost 6,000-7,000 crores in nature, and they seem to remain steady. So any guidance that you can give for that?
Yeah, so we've maintained that over the next 12 to 24 months, you will start seeing a decline in that this thing, because eventually all this liquidation will help in getting these money back.
Even our accrued interest, sir, are we getting this money or, you know, again, the accrued interest?
No, no, we are getting them.
Okay.
We are getting them.
Okay, sir. Thanks a lot.
Thank you. We take the next question from the line of Parag Charivala from Vito Capital. Please go ahead.
Thank you. Sir, I have two questions. One with regard to the earlier question, I mean the extension of earlier question. What actually made, in Reliance Capital, the debt level to go up, despite the fact that you highlighted that couple of investment you have liquidated? So have we invested somewhere else, or what exactly is that first? And secondly, you have, issued a press release stating that, there could be a private equity transaction in Reliance Home. So can you, further elaborate what size exactly you are looking at, timeline, or the kind of investor, etc.? Thank you.
Yeah. Hi, this is Ravindra. And on the press release, I would not like to add anything beyond what we have mentioned earlier, which says that we've entered into an exclusive discussion with an overseas investor for a potential equity investment by the investor in RHFL along with an appropriate governance framework. This is what we had announced earlier. And at this point in time, I think we would maintain our announcement.
And sir, by when you think that the home finance business would require capital? What tier one you are comfortable with?
So currently we are adequately capitalized, but yeah. this is what we thought we should inform, and hence we are given this.
No, but we are growing in upwards of 30-40%, right? So there is capital burning. So at what tier, like currently?
Currently we are well capitalized for the next 12 months at least.
Okay.
This transaction we're keeping in mind for the future, because we have, and we've stated earlier that our aspiration is to grow this book significantly over the next couple of years.
Sure. And sir, my first question is,
to answer your first question, a lot of our money has been invested in, which does not accrue regular income, and hence you've seen some amount of growth in the debt levels. But like we said, we've already started significant monetization of our assets from Codemasters, Yatra, etc. So you should see this number coming off from this year onwards.
So there is no fresh investment, non-core investment we have created?
No, we are not doing anything.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. We take the next question from the line of Shivakumar from Unify Capital. Please go ahead.
Yeah, thank you for the opportunity. Sir, my question is with regard to the commercial finance and the home finance arms. Basically, I was a bit concerned with regard to the capital market borrowing given the steep rise in the yield curve. So, what is the current cost of borrowing and what is the current leverage at both these arms?
So, talking about Reliance Home Finance, the cost of debt has just marginally gone up. As on June 18, we were at 8.8%. June 17, we were at 8.6% as a cost of debt. We are currently at 8.8%.
And your leverage would be what, sir, currently?
We are closing about 7%. Seven times.
Commercial finance, let me answer. Yes, capital market cost of incremental funding has gone up sharply. We run materially positive ALCO, so our borrowings are long denominated. So there is not much upward increase in our cost of funds at this point of time. But yes, as we go forward, there will be upward increase in cost of funds. Most of our book is variable priced, and hence, as appropriate, we will also do the adjustment in our pass on the increased cost of funds. Leverage, we are at 17.8% CAR, so approximately 5.2 times of leverage in commercial finance.
Okay, and incremental cost of borrowing, sir, for commercial finance?
Currently, incremental cost of borrowing depends on instrument to instrument, anywhere from 9.1 to 9.65. We have around 6% net interest margin. So this shift is, while it's an important shift, but it's not. It doesn't change the nuances of the business.
Right. So, and staying with the commercial finance. Now that you have slightly picked up traction in the two-wheeler finance and the retail personal loans, so what has been the growth, year-on-year growth segment-wise, if you can share, and what are your year-end targets in terms of AUM growth?
So I think retail lending is very new, so year-on-year growth will look very spectacular. I think what is important is we are 3% of AUM, because these are lower ticket lending, and our growth is exponential. So we would want to end with 10% AUM coming from retail in this fiscal.
Okay. And how was the trend in SME loans, sir? Because you are trying to degrow that segment, right? If I remember right.
SME has not been degrowing. We have been degrowing commercial vehicles and LAP. Segment, the SME segment has been growing robustly, and that marketplace offers a lot of opportunities, so, and we are very happy with the progress we have made in that segment lending.
Okay, and how is the quality of the book in the SME segment? So because most of the banks and NBFCs were seeing some stress in the SME segment of their loans. So how has it been for you?
SME segment is fairly steady in terms of quality of GNP and net NP as well as flow rates for incremental book. We are fairly small and we are niche in our place. So in our marketplaces, there is not much impact of increased loss rates.
Right. So, and the final question would be on the general insurance part. So, what is the combined ratio towards which the company is working towards for FY19 year end and maybe going forward by FY20?
Yeah, I think with each passing year, Reliance General Insurance has diversified its business opportunities and has also done incremental tie-ups for that, including various banks like Yes Bank, IndusInd Bank, Andhra Bank, UCO Bank. Structurally, it is like a build-up which we do, which brings us incremental improvements. If you really see our track record for last 2 years, every year we have improved the combined ratio between 4% to 5%. And I think we are fairly in line for this in the current year as well as going forward too.
Right. So, in the recent changes in the motor insurance policies, would that make you revise your growth targets for the premium?
The way the long-term motor policies have been introduced is that the policies are issued for a longer duration than 1 year, but the premium accounting is done on an annual basis. So, if you issue a three-year policy, you would actually account for one-third of the premium. So from a gross premium point of view, there won't be any change vis-a-vis a one-year policy for the entire market as well as for us. Having said that, you are likely to get, the entire three-year premium. So there should be an improvement in the AUMs and to that extent the corresponding revenues.
Sir, in the 44% motor business, how much will be third-party and how much will be own damage?
The split is more or less half to half.
Okay, great. Thank you, sir. That's it from my end.
Thank you. We take the next question from the line of Vikas Garg from L&T Mutual Fund. Please go ahead.
Thank you very much. Most of the questions have already been answered. Just one question on the data point. As you said that Code Master, you have received some 1,500 crores of money. And also, Yatra Online has been divested to an extent also. Will it be possible for you to share the current debt number as we speak? Thank you very much.
Not immediately, but I'll share that with you, Vikas, separately.
Sure, thank you very much.
Thank you. We take the next question from the line of Nidesh Jain from Investor Capital. Please go ahead.
Thanks for the opportunity, sir. So can you share the corporate loan book number as of FY18 and as of June 18 and the same number for non-core investment as of March 18 and June 18?
They'll be similar to the March numbers. No major change. We don't have it off immediately with us.
And what sort of reduction we expect by the end of FY19 in both of these numbers in terms of quantum, if you can suggest?
You should see a significant reduction going forward from this year.
By the end of FY19?
Yeah, FY19 onwards, you will see reduction. By FY20, significant would have been completed. But this year itself, you should see a reduction happening.
On Reliance Home Finance, I noticed the share of CF book has actually gone up sequentially. So,
sorry, share of?
Share of construction finance book has actually gone up on a sequential basis.
Yes.
As you mentioned that the decline in growth is because of you have slowed down your growth in construction finance book, but the share has gone up.
Yeah, so I would like to put it in two parts. See, firstly, if you look at the contribution of LAP in the incremental business that we have done in the last quarter, the contribution of LAP to the overall business has come down from the level of 35 in the same quarter last year to the level of 6% this year. While in the overall book, yes, there were certain accounts which we have attrited, but we have also sourced certain accounts. So, as an endeavor, as a prudent practice, we would continue to attract the accounts where we see stress coming up far ahead of the account getting into GNP or NPLs. So, as a prudent practice, we would continue doing that. But going forward, if you want to know where we would be on our midterm to long term, we would be closer to 55% on the home loan and affordable home loans. Directionally, we would be there.
Sure, sir. That's it from my side.
Thank you. We take the next question from the line of Amit Desai from HNI. Please go ahead.
Hi. My question, first of all, congratulations on decent set of numbers and becoming a CIC. My question is, have we changed accounting method for from this quarter?
Yes, we've moved to Ind AS from this quarter onwards.
Right. Now, actually, when I see the last financial year's quarter, actually it was in profit. And now we compared with a new accounting standard. It became a negative. So why sudden change of a few hundred crores from profit to loss? Is there anything which converts that profit into loss? I mean, I didn't get that, actually.
No, so we reported last year, we reported an Indian GAAP. This year it's in the air. While we did Ind AS, there were some transitional provision we need to do under ECL, etc. So we've done that, and you can see that impact in Q1 of last year.
Okay, so if we use the same methodology which we used last year, will this year's or this quarter's profit will be more by a couple of hundred crores?
No, not necessary. Not necessary. It'll be similar.
Okay. My second question is the exposure to ARCOM. I think somewhere there is a mention that Reliance Capital has exposure to ARCOM. Now, ARCOM is basically repaying all its debt. So does it mean that Reliance Capital will also get the money from Reliance?
Yeah, we should get some, yeah.
Okay. Now, one suggestion actually, last 11 years, I'm basically holding this Reliance Capital, but appreciation has not happened. Every investor wants the share to appreciate. Now, will there, recently Reliance Capital has given Reliance Home Finance as a bonus share. Now, will there be a discussion in the management that to give the next shares of Reliance Insurance or Reliance General Insurance as a part of Reliance Capital, or will it be a listing of those shares?
We can't comment on this.
Okay. One more last question. Recently, there was a news that Reliance Home Finance would be, some other investor would be investing money into the Reliance Home Finance. Now, will it be a dilution of the equity or will it be a selling of Reliance Capital at 25% stake in RHFL?
No, this will be primary infusion for the growth of that business, so there will be a dilution.
Dilution of the equity?
Yeah.
Okay. See, that's it. That's it from my side. Thank you.
Thank you. We take the next question from the line of Nitin Garg from Aviva Life. Please go ahead.
Thank you, sir, for taking my question. My question is pretty much the same. It's been more than 1 year that our company is under credit watch by CARE. So can you throw some light on that? What's the way forward and what are the developments which is happening?
No, so we'll have, since the results are out now, we'll have discussions with CARE and we'll see what best we can do to take care of our ratings.
Okay. Thank you. Are they satisfied, mother, with mother, if you had a preliminary
we'll have a discussion with them going forward.
Okay. Thank you. Thanks a lot, sir. That's it. Thank you.
Thank you. Before we take the next question, I would like to remind all participants, if you wish to ask a question, you may press star then one. Well, I would request all participants to please stay connected while we try to reconnect the management back to the conference. We take the next question from the line of Kajal Gandhi from ICICI Direct. Please go ahead.
Hello.
Kajal Gandhi, yes, you may please go.
Yeah. Yeah. So, did we have any DTA write-back on account of Ind AS? Because this is what has been seen in many of the financing companies. One question. And on the digital lending side, how is the experience panning out?
No, so there is no write-back of DTA in any of our businesses. And what's your second question?
So we are seeing commercial and home finance,
yeah,
there is a digital lending surge. Yeah.
So things, digital lending is a very wide terminology. Where we are focused is on two parts. One is forging partnership with digital ecosystem players, like we have announced our tie-up with PayU. It's an Asper company having very large customer base, and how can we work with them to create solutions for their customers, thereby also growing our business. The second part is using digital assets of mobility, which is processing an application using mobile phones, using APIs to Aadhaar and all other ecosystem players to be able to underwrite or disburse effectively. There our progress has been good, as we have mentioned in our investor presentation, that our platform is ready. It has processed 27,000 loans in last quarter, and it's growing very rapidly. So I hope I have answered your question. There will be opportunities in getting more customers from digital ecosystem, like partnership with PayU, which we have done, and also using digital assets to underwrite and lend better for improving customer experience as well as operating expense. That is on our operating platform improvement level. So both we have progressed well, and experience is quite good. When you work on a business rule engine, you have much more agility in risk management. We are too, just now the business is too small, but these are good capabilities to have for future.
Okay. So, what is the ticket size in SME loans that you are giving through digital actually?
So, our SME loans, we are not doing, we are processing our SME applications through digital assets. We are not sourcing SMEs from digital lending platform. Our average ticket size are approximately 45 to 50 lakhs, because it differs segment to segment. Equipment finance is at 20-25 lakhs, and SME loans backed by property as a collateral are around 1 crore.
Sir, are you also eligible to do mudra loans, or it is only the banks?
No, even we can originate mudra loans. We already work with SIDBI on that program, but we are not very large in that space at this point of time, because there are certain restrictions on price which gets charged, etc., etc. So we are studying that space. We work with SIDBI very closely. Currently, our mudra loan portfolio is not very large.
Okay, sir, how is your experience on these fresh digital lending in terms of repayments or the asset quality issues or anything?
No, I think our total book is up less than 5 crores. These are too early observations. I think depending on partnership to partnership, the proposition on pricing as well as on delinquency will differ. So far, we are happy with what we have seen in PayU in terms of early bounces.
Okay, thank you. So, on last question on the this debt side, which was getting answered on this, that we have already got money from two large ticket sizes, that is the gaming company and the, so that we have paid off to repay the debt, then
yes.
what has led to the increase? So that's what I wanted. So ideally, it should have come down, correct?
No, so this money has come in this financial year. You were talking about the last financial year in this.
No, I am talking whether what. So June quarter, so this number, is the debt down than March quarter?
Yeah.
Because you have not reported the number, so I am just.
Yeah.
Okay. Okay, sir. Thank you very much.
Thank you. We will take the next question from the line of Rohit Chopra from Sigma Street. Please go ahead.
Hi. Thanks for the opportunity. Just wanted to check this, your FY18 annual report, the net worth reported in that, that would include all the Ind AS adjustments? So that is post those adjustments?
No, FY18 was Indian GAAP.
Okay, so would you be able to say that what is the impact on net worth on account of this Ind AS adjustments?
No, we'll report that in September.
Okay. And then just a follow-up question on this Codemaster. So the profit on the transaction would not be reflected in the Reliance Capital consolidated accounts?
No. We've got our debt exposure back from the...
Okay. So, okay. So the money has been received then?
Yes.
Okay. And then you talked about the Reliance General IPO in your opening remarks. So is there any timeline on that or are you just awaiting appropriate market conditions?
I think, you know, we are just looking at the market conditions and, you know, we are ready to launch our issue as we see. And I must also emphasize here that we have all the approvals both from SEBI and IRDAI in place.
Okay. And just one final question. I mean, because of this Ind AS, it's a new thing for many of us. Whatever had to happen, assuming steady state, has it happened? So the Q2 results, will they be... So, I mean, one of the participants talked about a large swing from profit last year to loss for the same period last year. So, this Q2, will it sort of be a steady state and we will be able to, I mean, just compare steady state or will there again be swings on account of Ind AS?
Yeah, so we can't comment on the Q2 numbers. We've not worked on that. But for this financial year, numbers are steady state. Q1 is good. Q2 should also continue to
No, so what I'm trying to figure out, will this Ind AS volatility, will it continue in the coming quarters or, I mean, assuming things stay steady state?
It may. It may for the previous financial year.
Okay, that's it. Thank you.
Thank you. Well, that seems to be the last question for today. I would now like to hand the conference over to Ms. Ashutosh Mishra for his closing comments.
Thank you, everyone, for actively participating in the call, and thanks to the management for giving their perspective. Thank you.